pumped to be here with you guys today. Dub has changed my life. The last piece or the last segment of my presentation here actually is how I use Dub. So I'm going to give you the 7 ways personally as an expert, as a consultant, as a speaker, how I use Dub. And I hope to inspire you to use Dub as well. It's my number one tool. I don't work without Dub, and I will talk about that later. But the topic today is the 3 key elements to improve your virtual presentations. My background, I work with Tony Robbins from 2002 to 2008. My background, I'm from Brazil originally. And when I came to America, I've been here living in America for 25 years. And I came here and I remember studying English 25 years ago. I read this one question changed my life. And the question was, if I could do anything in my life and I knew I could not fail, what am I doing today right here, right now? And I'm sure most of you have heard this question before, but most people don't answer. And I really stop. And I really asked myself, if I could do anything really in my life, what I'll be doing today right here, right now. And I didn't have an answer at that time. My background in Brazil, I work in a bank. And I said, you know what? I don't know. So I went to this journey, self-development journey, and I ended up meeting someone who introduced me to an interview at the Anthony Robbins companies, and I got a job. So when I got a job at Tony Robbins, my job was to do back in 2002, I was doing around 400 talks a year. So basically, I used to go to any company that had a sales team, a sales force, or a group, and used to do a 45-minute presentation and sell Tony Robbins tickets to his events, Unleash the Power Within. That's how I started my career speaker. Fast forward 2,000 plus talks later, I'm here to talk to you today. And the reason I chose this topic is because the presentation, how you communicate to your prospective clients and patients have changed. Now, I like to call that right now we are in a presentation 5.0. Presentation 1.0, imagine just you giving a presentation to a group of people, 5 people, 10 people, right? Just you talking to them. That's what I call presentation 1.0. Presentation 2.0 is when you traditionally, we start adding technology. And technically, most of us start using PowerPoint presentations or Keynote to add visuals to presentation. So, by the way, I'm not saying the presentation 2.0 is better than 1.0. I'm just saying the evolution of the presentation game, how you communicate your message to your clients. Then 2010, what happens? YouTube, I think it was 2009, 2010. This is actually my first video I ever recorded, April 19, 2010. And for me, video marketing, recording video has always been an extension of public speaking, an extension of communicating your message. It's just more leverage because once the talk is done, the video gets recorded and people can play it. Just makes sense. So that's the evolution of communication. And then you have the presentation 4.0, where we are right now. Doing a webinar, we have people from all over the US, have people from England here. I love that. Where are we doing a webinar? As you see, the presentation communication game has changed dramatically. And then you have the 5.0. During the COVID, I was invited to do a presentation in Arizona for this group. And we had 20 people in the room and 200 online. That's what they call the hybrid event. And I'm here to tell you that if you are in the expert business, that means that you have an expertise and you sell that expertise to groups or to people, to markets, then, and if you were doing events before COVID or you're doing online virtual events right now, that is the future of the event industry, is hybrid events. That's the future, because before, technology did not allow to the small business to create a quote-unquote hybrid event. Cost a lot of money. Now with a good camera, good mic, you can have 10 people here and broadcast everywhere. So that's the beauty of where we are today. And then we have this. This is a scenario today, right? Because when I say the word virtual presentation, it's like, wow, what is virtual presentation? Could it be a lot of things? So personally, the way I frame in my mind, we have primarily, I don't think, 9 or 10 different types of virtual presentations. We have one-on-one videos, which is, I use Dub. Dub for me is the best platform. I'll be talking about how I use it. You have live videos when you go live, multi-streaming. You have videos that traditionally record and upload on YouTube, Instagram, LinkedIn. You have Zoom meetings when you go online with your prospective client. Everybody is used to do Zoom meetings. You have online seminars. I happen to do a 3-day event online now. It's 2.5 days, 10 hours a day. It's amazing. People cannot believe it. Like, man, it's impossible to be in front of a computer for 10 hours. Like, oh, not with me, right? Then you have private videos. Some of you have private membership sites, which we have too. Live webinars, what are you doing right now? Pre-recorded webinars. Someone was asking for the recording already. Yeah, we're going to have the recording. Then you have podcasts. Podcasts traditionally start with the audio. Now you have video podcast. And then you have virtual keynotes where someone hire you to go to a conference to do a half an hour talk, a 45-minute talk. So everything here in this big umbrella is what I call virtual presentations. Now, we're not going to have time. We don't have 3 days here. We have, you know, 40 minutes or so. But I just want to create a context here. When I say the word virtual presentation, I'm talking about all these categories here. And I have a very simple framework to explain how anybody can elevate their virtual presentation game in all these areas. And my framework, I call the 3M framework. So the first one is the messenger, is you. And I know Darius, you guys, and Ruben, you guys work with video. I know so many people who would like to be doing online seminars, would like to be doing their own webinars, would like to be using Dub consistently, but they don't do because there's a block psychologically. And what I found, I've been doing this since 2002, communication training, public speaking training, presentation training, is that the number one thing that stops people is this FUNDA. Roberto, what is FUNDA? Fear, uncertainty, nervousness, doubt, anxiety. Some people can actually force themselves into recording a video and say, oh, I forced myself, or I got super excited and I did it. But I'm talking about going from a place from, you know what? I actually love to be able to communicate a message. I love to be able to help people. And psychologically, emotionally, feels amazing. So the number one thing before we talk about any technology or content or ideas for you to market your service, your product, your software, you got to be able to address psychologically your mindset, your psychology is really important. And I noticed that people have this different level of impact. This graph here shows that the higher you go here, the higher is your impact. So we have some people have phobia. Some people don't like speaking, don't like communicating. Some people don't like say, Roberto, I like communicating, but I hate closing. I hate to offer, talk about my service or my product. Some people don't record videos. Some people don't speak to peers. And my goal every time, every single time I communicate, and I hope that my message resonates with you today, is that I want to make sure people go at this level, that when you expand your identity and you realize that, you know what? I love my product. I love my service. I love to serve people. I love to help people. And I am an accountant and I'm a financial planner and I'm a marketer and speaker. I am a doctor and speaker. I am a consultant and speaker. I am a doctor and speaker. I am a veterinarian and speaker. Because when you love speaking, speaking loves you back. Please write it down. When you love speaking, when you love communicating using video, virtual presentations, speaking loves you back. And then you receive a lot of benefits from this. Now, the number one thing that people want to, that hold them back, the number one thing by far is the fear of being judged. People don't want to communicate from a camera because, man, I don't want to be judged. What if I prospect these people? What if I do that Dub video that Darius told me and I reach out to the CEO or this company and they, man, they don't like me. And then I feel bad. They're going to judge me. Experienced fear of being judged has nothing to do with intelligence. You can be super intelligent, but then you still allow this fear stop you from taking action. And I had this big realization years ago that I actually wrote down a piece of paper. And here's what I wrote. I said, the ultimate form of being judged happens when someone that needs my help is willing to pay for my help, doesn't know I exist. Let me say again, and I hope that belief really caused to change how you see fear of being judged when you record yourself, when you communicate in front of a camera. I have this really powerful belief that I wrote down. I said, look, the ultimate form of fear of being judged happens when someone that needs my help is willing to pay for my help, doesn't know I exist, because in his or her mind, you know, I never heard about this guy, this four, he's not that good. Because not knowing you, not knowing your company, not knowing your product, not knowing your service, it is a type of judgment. Does that make sense? If someone in the marketplace right now that needs you, needs your service, is willing to pay for your service or product or software right now, and that person doesn't know you or your company or your service, now they have a judgment. Maybe it's not bad judgment. Unknown, oh, I just don't know this person. Therefore, it's not that good. Because if you were really good, guess what? I will have heard about this person or this company, this software. And the only way for you to change that is through communication. So what if you were to approach your day thinking, you know what? The people who are not doing business with me, they already have a judgment about me anyway. And the only way for me to change that judgment is what? By what? By communicating. Think about that. Because that's like, look, so I don't want to be judged. Guess what? Not knowing who you are, not knowing your product, not knowing your service, there's already a judgment in the marketplace. Maybe it's not a bad one, just they don't know. And the only way for you to change that is through communication. Think about that. Now, the second point when it comes to the messenger is this, is that I've seen that some people are very consistent with videos, live videos, one-on-one videos, dub, presentations. Some people are not. And that consistency comes from their purpose and their identity. Now, I've done a three-day event just on this pyramid here. Won't spend too much time right now. This is an adaptation from the work of Robert Diltz. He talks about neurological levels of thinking. Basically, talks about how people, you and I, we think in levels. And our thinking has a hierarchy. And the higher you go in a pyramid, the purpose, the identity, the biggest the change. So let's say, for example, I'm an accountant right now. My purpose is to make sure to take care of my clients' books. I comply with the law, right? My identity, how I see myself, I'm a great accountant. My values, I value the law. I value precision. I value integrity. I have very specific beliefs about bookkeeping, let's say. I have my skills and capabilities. I got my CPA degree. I got my license. My behavior, I go to the office. I read financial documents. I read the laws, the updates, and I invite my office. Okay, very simple to understand. Let's say one day, I don't want to be an accountant anymore. I want to be a priest. Okay, I want to be a pastor. It's totally a dramatic change here for you to understand, to make this super element here, this graph, to make sure you understand. So let's say I change my purpose in life. I want to be a priest or a pastor right now. Everything else right now changes, right? I have my purpose is to spread the word of God. My identity, I have to see myself differently. I have to adopt different value systems. What's important to me? I have new beliefs about communication. As an accountant, I don't have to speak in public or record videos. As a priest or pastor, if I want to have a big church, I have to. There's no other way around it, right? It's skills. I got to be able to counsel people. I got to be able to communicate. I got to be able to do a sermon. My behaviors, I speak, I do sermons, I counsel. My environment is the church. Now, I gave you these two dramatic examples, different examples, just to make pops in your mind. Okay, I get it. I understand this. And here's what happens. This is very important. Have you ever been in a seminar, in an event, when you learn some amazing information, the technique, how to, and you fail to implement? And if you say, Roberto, that happened to me before, is because you learned something in my skill level. They taught a new skill, how to prospect, how to record a video, how to close, how to do time management. This is how you do it. Go home and do 10 times. Put in your calendar. Do 10 times a day, 20 times a day, and do in your office, which is good. But the reason didn't last is because those behaviors, they are not attached to your identity, to the higher level of thinking, which is your purpose and your identity. So when I talk about virtual presentation, when I talk about video, when you talk about dub, you talk about live videos or webinars, or how you get your message, your product, your service, your app, your software to the masses, you have your identity, how you see yourself, you have to expand. Because when you change how you see yourself, your audience changes how they see you. When you change how you see yourself, your audience changes how they see you. And there is a massive opportunity for you to create an amazing impact right now using this technology. One of the stories that I like to share about identity, this is LeBron James. Some of you know LeBron. And when he was 15, he tattooed his back, the chosen one. And what happened was, this is before playing the NBA. Now, if you wake up in the morning thinking, man, I'm the chosen one. I'm the chosen one. I'm the chosen one. That is a very strong identity statement. Yes? Now, what happens with LeBron start playing the NBA, and now he won 4 titles, broke the several records. And I remember, for those who follow basketball here, 3 or 4 years ago, LeBron James was playing Cleveland, and he was going against Golden State Warriors playing basketball. And for those who don't follow basketball, in a season, they play 82 games. And that year, Golden State was the best team with the best record ever. Just to have an idea, Michael Jordan, he was playing basketball. In 82 games, Chicago Bulls, they won 72, lost 10. That is the best a team has ever done. At that year, Golden State broke Michael Jordan's record. They won 73 games, lost 9. And now the best from the West playing the best from the East. And LeBron James left Miami, went to play in Cleveland. And Cleveland has not won a title in 60 years. Now, best of 7 games. And I remember watching an interview after the game. Now, Warriors, the team from West Coast, they won 3 games. Cleveland just won 1 game. So the next game, if the Warriors won, they're going to be the champion. And I never forget this. 3-1, right? And the reporter asked LeBron, say, hey, LeBron, you promised when you came from Miami to Cleveland that you're going to bring a title. And now you're going against the best team ever with the best record ever. Not only that, they won 3 games. Your team just won 1. And no team ever has came back on a final from 3-1. And the reporter asked this question, are you stressed out? And LeBron said, no. I'm like, it's not stressed out? I ought to be stressed out. And he goes, don't you feel the weight in your shoulders? You promised a title and now you're about to lose? It's like, no. And the reporter said, how come? And he said, because every single day when I wake up, I stay true to the game of basketball and I live with the results. When he said that, my mind literally exploded like, phew! And I'm like, what? He said, every single day when I wake up, I stay true to the game of basketball and I live with the results. And then I realized that in life, most people, the reason they're complaining about the leads, lack of sales, because the life stuff, is because they're not staying true to the game they're playing. And I ask you, as an entrepreneur, coach, consultant, expert, leader, are you staying true to the game you're playing? And I realized, like, man, there's a whole new level for me. And when I watch this, I realized, you know what? There's a whole new level for myself that I have to tap into it. And LeBron went there, 3-2, 3-3, 4-3. I won. And I think I always go back to, because his identity, this is before he put his tattoo, before start playing the NBA, when in high school. Now, some of you are thinking, Roberto, are you asking me to put a chosen one, a tattoo in my back? I'm like, no, that's not the point. But what if in your heart of hearts, right here, right now, today, you were to tell yourself, you know what? You don't have to communicate that to the public, but you tell yourself that you are the chosen one to communicate your message, your product, your service to the world right now, that you are the chosen one. How much more force, more power, more charisma, more influence, more consistency would you have? What happened if you believe with the same level of certainty that your name is your name, that you're like, you know what? I am the chosen one to take this message, to help this marketplace, to revamp my industry, to pivot my company. I am the chosen one. With the same level of certainty that you know your name, would you behave differently? And every single time I ask this question, people say, yep, of course. And that's why when it comes to this conversation about virtual presentations, whatever your profession is, whatever you do, I want you to add, I do this and I'm a virtual presenter. I'm an accountant and a virtual presenter. I'm a lawyer and a virtual presenter. I'm a sales professional and a virtual presenter. I'm a consultant and a virtual presenter. I'm a coach and a virtual presenter. I'm a personal trainer and a virtual presenter. I don't want you to change who you are. I want to inspire you to expand who you are. It's not about changing who you are. It's about expanding who you are. Because when you change how you see yourself, what happens? Your audience changes how they see you. The third point about mindset here is this, is that your beliefs about virtual presentations, about videos, determines how you feel, determines your creativity, your desire, and your mindset to record videos, to do dubs, to do webinars, to do presentations, determines your actions, your results. So what do you have to believe personally about virtual presentations? And I have a list of them. We don't have time to cover, but it's this. In the end of the day, it's about them, not about you. A lot of people don't want to be in front of a camera. They don't want to record. They don't want to lead because they're self-conscious or they experience the funda that I just talked about, fear, uncertainty, nervousness, down, anxiety. And what I realized that in communication, it's always about moving someone from point A to point B. Point A, where they are. Point B, you want to leave them better. Today, you came here with one knowledge, with one mindset about virtual presentations. We hope to leave you to point B, better. And the best thing that I can share with you here today is that the people that you know in your life, in your company, in your community, that don't record videos, don't do dubs, don't do webinars, don't do online seminars, don't do live videos, is because they're making the presentation about them. Just like in this picture here, imagine you have a spotlight in your face, and the light is so bright they respecting me? How do I look? How do I sound? Am I too skinny? Am I too overweight? My nose is too big. My hair, I don't have hair. My hair is too, whatever the conversation is, instead of realizing. By the way, as long as you have this focus on yourself, you're not going to be able to take massive action. I promise you. Now, the moment when you change the focus is about the audience, 100%. Yes. Yes, you're leading. Yes, you're recording. Yes, in front of a camera. Yes, you're talking. Yes, you have a mic. Yet, it's about them. It's about every time you open your mouth, every story you share, every question you ask, every statistic you tell, every demonstration you do is about moving audience from point A, where they are in their lives, point B, better. It's that simple. When you realize that you, the presenter, you're not even the picture, things you change dramatically. Things will change dramatically. Now, Gary Smith is fear, uncertainty, nervousness, doubt, and anxiety. The second M is about the message. So once your mindset's ready to go, so now I'm going to talk about the message. And the message is this: an educated client is the best client. I want to talk about a study, actually is a principle in persuasion. It's called ELM, Elaboration Likelihood Model. And what happens that I'm assuming everybody here in a webinar today in the business of selling or in the business of influence. If you're not selling a product or service, maybe you're selling a software, maybe you're selling an idea, idea selling. And what happens is this, according to the researchers, but this is not my idea, this is communication research. When you present your message, your audience, they use one of two routes. They call different routes of persuasion. Okay, super simple to understand. One is called the central route. And the central route means like when you present your idea, your audience, could be an audience of one or audience of many, what they do, they actually take the time to break down your arguments. They take the time to understand your audience, your arguments. That's called the central route. So for example, when Darius did his presentation of Dub here, his demo, you actually follow along. You'd be like, you know what? Dub is an amazing tool. It makes so much sense for me. You actually, I can record, I can share, I can customize. That makes sense. So you follow his argument. Now, every time you present your idea and your audience is A, motivated, B, is able to understand. That means like not only you're motivated to learn, but you're able to understand the message, two different things. Motivated to learn, able to understand. They're going to engage in a process called high elaboration. And high elaboration is that when they think about the message, like, you know what? That double thing is a really good thing. Virtual presentation makes sense. They get engaged in a process, which means to lasting change. Now, sometimes though, your audience, and you experience that, if you're in sales, experience that, people, instead of, they may not be motivated enough to learn, or they may not be able to understand, meaning like they are motivated, but like, man, they cannot comprehend the topic because the topic might be too complicated for them. If your audience is not motivated or they're not able to understand, now they're going to engage in what psychologists and communication researchers talks about peripheral cues. And peripheral cues might be something like, you know what? I just like that guy. He's from Brazil. I'm from Brazil. Or I like that. He lives in LA. I live in LA. Whatever the conversation is, we went to the same high school or you like the same sports team. So what happens is that when you present your idea, this is very important because I'm going to tie back this to video technology. When you communicate and you present your message and your audience engage or make a decision, say, yes, I want to buy your stuff. Yes, I want to buy your product. Yes, I want to buy your service. Yes, I want to hire as a consultant. And they engage in peripheral cues, meaning they like your information. They like your office. They like the, you guys are in the same high school. They like your personality. What happens is that they engage temporary change and usually they pay you, they use your service, and they stop. By the way, sometimes you don't have control on the peripheral route of persuasion. Because sometimes you show up to a presentation and people are like, man, I just like you, let's do it. You don't have control. But what you do have control, and this is like really important, okay, really important. We can take someone who makes decisions using peripheral cues, like they like you, they like your office, they like your logo, they like your energy. Eventually, you gotta be able to take them here to be motivated enough and able enough to engage in high elaboration, high thinking about your message. Why? Because that's what we want to create, what? Lasting change. So how does tie back to virtual presentations? Answer, video. So if you're not using video marketing, virtual presentations, Dub, to consistently educate your clients, prospective clients, patients, you're leaving money on the table. You know why? Because you experience most likely you're converting people, but you have a poor retention. And the reason have poor retention because you're converting them using peripheral cues and they're not thinking about your message, the benefits of your message. Okay. I want to bring some research to back it up. So how do you do it? You educate by teaching them new beliefs. Now, this is a paradigm on content marketing. And I hope that if you want to get one thing out of today, get this. I want you guys to become really good with this methodology we created. It's called the persuasion belief method. Whatever you sell, product, service, software, idea, fundraising, whatever it is, I want you to imagine you have, 100,000 people who are your prospective clients or patients, your avatar, your ideal clients. Imagine there's 100,000 of them in front of you. What I want you to think, what do they have to believe in order to act? What do they have to believe in order to buy my product? What do they have to believe in order to buy my service? What do they have to believe in order to hire me? What do they have to believe in order to buy my software? What's going to happen is you're going to find something called the primary belief. I'm going to give an example later. The primary belief. My example here, if 100,000 people are there of a prospective ideal clients, avatar, what do they have to believe in order to hire you, to buy your stuff? That's number one thing. Then you're actually going to have a belief because you see, every behavior is belief driven. Everything that you do or don't do comes from belief system. Anything that your clients do or don't do comes from belief system. If you use Dub because you believe that Dub can help you, right? If you don't believe Dub because you don't believe it yet, you don't have the belief yet. If you work out 5 times a week, you believe that working out is good for you. If you don't, then you don't have the belief. Right? Would you like to have the belief, but you don't have yet. So this is a really powerful exercise. So once you have that, the second thing I want you to do, I want you to go like this. In order to believe X, X was a primary belief. Let me go back here. You start here. Why do they have to believe in order to act? Then you're going to write it down. They have to believe that blank. Then the next thing you're going to do, you're going to say, in order to believe blank or X, what else do they have to believe? Now what you're going to find, is secondary beliefs. They also have to believe this, this, and this. And that, my friends, once you go through this process, that becomes the foundation of your sales message, the foundation of your content marketing strategy, the foundation of your email marketing, the foundation of your campaigns, the foundation of your sales copy in your page. Because if you agree with me, that everything we do or don't do comes from a belief system, either conscious beliefs or unconscious beliefs. If you believe that, then the next question is, okay, what else do they have to believe? If the things you do, human nature, you do or don't comes from a belief system, Tony Robbins said, every human behavior is belief driven. Then the question is, what do they have to believe? I want you to ask yourself, what else do they have to believe? So in my example here, by the way, this is like, I'm giving you the 1% here just for time purposes. I spent an hour just on this process along in our class. But here you go. Primary belief. In my example, so I teach a 3-day class on virtual presentations, how to acquire more clients. So I wrote it. Virtual presentations is one of the most effective ways to generate new business right now. So when I'm promoting my services, I want my clients, prospective clients, people don't know me, believe that. Then I got to go, okay, what else do I have to prove in my copy? What else do I have to prove in my emails, my content marketing? Then I wrote, well, virtual presentations get results, obviously. They can do it, themselves can do it. It's affordable to do it. They can start now. So I list all these secondary beliefs. And then the primary belief and secondary beliefs becomes the foundation of my content marketing strategy. Becomes my foundation of my Dub message, of my live videos. And if you go to my sales page, all those beliefs, I actually transform those beliefs, right? And then I prove that they're true. Now, it's not like you're going to approach your clients and say, hey, believe that. It doesn't work like that. In influence, it doesn't work like that. But this is kind of the framework of you to think about your sales message, your marketing message. Because a lot of people, they say, got to create content. And they create content all over the place. That's not effective. I wanted to stop and think in terms of like, okay, why do they have to believe in order to buy from me? Simple. Then you're going to ask yourself, okay, for them to believe that, what else do they have to believe? And you list it. You're going to have a list. Depending on what you sell, you're going to have a small list or big list. And then that becomes a foundation of your content marketing strategy. The second point is this. You got to be able to tell stories. Stories are really powerful because they reduce sales resistance. people can counter argue your message. People cannot counter argue your stories because your personal experiences, right? One of the reasons I love storytelling so much is because stories increase the value of things. Now, there's a study done called Significant Objects, and scientists, they want to know, hey, if you get an object like a mug, a coffee mug, right? And you attach something, a story, does it increase or decrease the value of the cup? And they did a study, and what they did, they got these objects, they pay $1.50, they hire professional copywriters, and they put the object and the stories on eBay and to see if the story was powerful enough to increase the value of things. And here's the result, right? Which is really powerful. Smiley mug, the scientists bought for $2, sold for $32. The bowling bag, salt shaker, they pay $0.50, sold for $49. The banana, which I have a banana in my office that I carry as a reminder, they pay $0.25, sold for $76. It's crazy. By the way, the duplicate study, they bought 100 objects, they pay $128, and they sold for $3,600. Why? Because the stories were able to move people into action. Storytelling is something that you can use everywhere, in your dubs, in your live videos, online seminars, webinars. I just shared the story, LeBron James, staff meetings. Storytelling is one of the most powerful communication tools that you can use in your presentation. One of my clients, he had $50,000 a month in collections. And all he did, he started thinking stories. And I love what Darius showed you guys before, the playlists. Every single time someone says something nice, his line was, hey, your story can help many people who are struggling in our community. Do you mind sharing with us? And then people start sharing. So now he has his stories in written form, video form. He does ads with his stories. It's super powerful. One of my favorite tools, I'm going to talk about right now how I use Dub, is because the video reply. Now, obviously, I'm going fast here on my framework. The messenger, you, the presenter, always more important. And two, okay, the message. How organize my message? I gave a couple ideas today. You start thinking in terms of like, okay, number one, I know that I gotta really educate people. So use video technology to educate them. Because some of your clients or patients, they buy from you, but they don't use your information and they quit later because they're using peripheral cues. They like you, they like your energy, they like your charisma, but they don't understand your message. They gotta engage in high elaboration or thinking about your message. Right? Talk about that. And then one of the most powerful things about your message, write it down on a piece of paper. Hey, what do they have to believe to buy from me? Write it down. What else do they have to believe? And you list it. I recently had a huge breakthrough and I teach that I forgot one belief. I really forgot one belief. I tell the story. My sales copy for my event, I said, what do they have to believe, right? So, oh, they have to believe that virtual presentations is the way to go. And what else do they have to believe? Then I go, well, they have to believe this. And then I publish and start selling. My course is doing great, but I realized that I forgot one belief that I didn't educate my clients and my prospective clients that the best place to learn virtual presentations, it is not virtual environment. It's not a traditional hotel room. What is the best place to learn how to cook? In a garage or in a kitchen? In a kitchen, right? Duh. You're like, duh. Yeah, I know. So what is the best place to learn video or virtual presentations or virtual environment? By the way, I know it sounds simple, but guess what? I didn't address that. I'm an expert teaching that, and I forgot about it. Now I address that. See yourself as a virtual presenter. See yourself as a video marketer. Spend. Develop your content. Number three, marketing. And there's so many things you can do with marketing. So many things. Some of them are very complicated. And I mentioned this to Ruben and Darius before. I know them for a year and a half. They're not paying me to say this. This is from my heart. Dub changed my career. Changed my life. Before I using another software, I had an account, another software. Never use it. Heard about Dub. Got Dub. For the first 3-4 months, didn't use it. My fault, I didn't use it. And I remember going to an event and a guy gave me a business card. He goes, oh, your talk was amazing. Call me. I'm like, okay. And I'm on an airport. I'm like, you know what? I'm going to try that Dub thing. And I went to my app. I go, click, 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 click. Sent the guy. Was a veterinarian. He goes, in my 40-year career, nobody ever recorded me a video like that. I want to come to your class. And I'm like, damn, my focus go, wah, Dub. And everything that I do with something about me, either I am all in 100% or zero. I don't do nothing at 50% capacity. So this is my account at Dub. I record 1,706 videos. I love Dub every day. And obviously, Dub has so many amazing tools that I'm not even using. I try to use them all and learn. But something what I love about Dub, if you don't have Dub, these guys, they walk the talk. They have always new features. Now I know we have a teleprompter. I'm like, man, I gotta learn that too. I love Dub because the philosophy, always reinvesting in the tool, is just amazing. So I just want to share with you how I use it. I want to be super clear. I'm not an expert. I just want to share how I use it for my business. My favorite tools. Number one, event promotion to my mailing list. While I start doing Dub 101 originally, which is the power, the customization of the message, when Darius talking about promoting Dub, recording Dub to one person, that is the number one tool. I realized that my newsletters, the engagement go higher. So much so that now, the last 4 months or so, every single time I write an email, I got a sale, which is weird. But I know why. You know why? Because I embed a Dub and I blast to my entire mailing list. So it's not like everybody watched, but people who, I write a paragraph and then I embed my Dub. It's phenomenal, phenomenal. So in this example, I'm going to share 7 ways I use it. One, event promotion in my mailing list. My number one mistake in my career was not paying attention to my mailing list. I was so focused on speaking, I didn't pay attention to the people who raised their hand. And now all my emails, I include a Dub, all of them. Here's the example here. I have a class, so that's an event promotion mailing list. Second thing that I do a live stream pretty much every day. I have 2 companies and I do a lot of live stream, go live, different platforms. But I realize when you go live, you're live on, you know, Facebook page, groups page, LinkedIn, YouTube, you go everywhere. But I'm not communicating to my list, right? Now, some people might be in a live on the social media platforms. But what I do now, I download my live. Guess what I do? I put on my Dub account so I don't have to re-record a video, and now I blast to my list. So I repurpose my live videos, which most people don't do. I don't know why. And this has been a game changer for me. Amazing. I want to be the Matrix. Remember the Matrix? You look around, the guy is there. I'm like, man, it's the Matrix. So use Dub, use live streaming technology to do it. So number 3, get client testimonials. I did an event last weekend. This feature is game changing because a lot of times when you ask testimonial, if people are not there in your office, can you go home and do it? They'll be like, ah, I will. Gotta put makeup. I gotta do this. I gotta do that. It's just harder. We Dub, like, look. And I say, all you have to do, make sure you press the button, record it, and then you send it. And I will receive it from me only. It's amazing. Like, amazing. So I use that feature a lot. And I also use that feature to my clients and say, hey, why you want to learn? What's a big challenge? So for my private coaching clients, I send that to you. You just make the job easier on them. Number 4, download pre-event manuals. Let's say you have a meeting. Let's say you do an event. Let's say you have I do a 3-day event. So what I do, I always build up value before the event, so increase the show up rate. So what I do, Dub has a feature where you can upload a document and I record a video. And it's, hey, by the way, guys, super simple. All you have to do, click the button here and then click it. Boom, the document. Super professional. And what I love about Dub, specifically in this feature, I don't need to find a designer or a website guy to do that. I can do it. I'm not a technical guy. It's like, that's the beauty about it. To become a virtual presenter, you don't have to be a techie. Really. You got to have a message. You got to have a good psychology, the messenger, good message, and understand the fundamentals of technology. It's not complicated. Number 5, join private groups. So I have several private groups and I love it. So I send an email or a video or Dub, right? I say, hey, by the way, join my group. Here's why. And I tell the benefits of joining my group because I feel like sometimes when you're doing a class and event, some people are not ready to buy, but they want to be connected to you. And joining your private group on Facebook, for example, might be a good option for us. It's been an amazing option. So I use that. And then number 1, one-on-one prospecting with testimonials. Today, I send this video today. I was prospecting. I have a class coming up on the 26th, 27th, 28th. So I send this video, I screenshot what I send out. And by the way, here's how I think about messaging when I do Dub. The 3 C's, connection, content, call to action. Connection, I try to find some element. Just connect to them. Either I go to LinkedIn account, Facebook account, or research online, or I met a person, we have a friend in common. I have some element of connection right in the beginning of the video. Then the content, what it is. Sometimes I tell a story when it's appropriate. Sometimes I don't, but I got to be short. And then I have a call to action, which is the feature that Darius talked about. And very elegantly, I say, hey, you want to check out what other people are saying right here? And just like right there. And I'm like, man, this is amazing. So I use that a lot. And this one, I have 2 brands. I have an Influenceology that I started in 2009. And we work with the 40 industries. And I have another brand, which is Kairos Speaking Company. It's one of the industries I serve. So there's a feature on Dub, which is amazing. It's called presets. And for someone like me or like you that have, saves you a ton of time because I have different logos, I have different colors, I have different testimonials, I have different pages, I have different links. Everything is kind of like the core service is the same, but how they perceive is different. So I can go, just go one click, the whole preset changes, which is amazing. As a marketer, which I am, part of my identity, that saves me so much time. They're not paying me to do it. I just share them. If you don't have an account, just open up account Dub. This is amazing.